peace of the outer world. We just, only in the morning hours, we just stop here. Local, the police cops allow us just to stop here, our bus, and then we can go across the road taking pictures and coming back.
Warriors ruled over different areas. Like for example, this area was ruled by Kashwaha clan of Rajput warriors. Jodhpur, we are going to, was ruled by Rathod Talokhas to Kwari. We will be going to Udaipur and Zahir, ruled by Sisodia Talokhas to Kwari. So this dynasty here was founded by King Dhule Rai. He used to be the prince in central India, but he was exiled out of his state. And then he took shelter here. At that time, this area was ruled by fierce Meera tribesmen. But one night, this prince Dhule Rai betrayed, and by getting the Meera chieftain, he murdered him and conquered over the state of Amir around 12th century AD. So that's how this dynasty came in existence. So they ruled from here until 1727, then they shifted to Jaipur. I told you that who were dressing the second visa in the city of Jaipur. Before that, they were here. So you see, in Agra we saw the Mughal four palaces, but here we are visiting the Rajput Hindu four palaces, and they constructed their palaces, of course, very strategically. The reason, because quite often they were busy in fighting against the Muslim invaders who came from outside, or Central Asian invaders. And if not against them, then they were so fond of wars and battles that they were fighting with each other. I mean, for these warriors going to the battlefield, it was like they are going to some tournament. Yeah, exactly. It was like a tournament for them going to the battlefield. And you know, some of the, not only these Rajput warriors were brave, their wives were equally brave. You know those Rajput ladies, what they did during the medieval time when the Muslim invaders came here, and suppose if they conquered over some state, then they used to take the, I told you, the beautiful girls by force. So rather than being found in the hands of the enemies, they performed Johar. You know Johar, what is Johar? You know, when a Rajput warrior lady sent her husband to the battlefield, she used to put an auspicious mark on the forehead. And she used to request her that either conquer the battlefield or die, fight until you die. Don't lose the battle. So, and so suppose the Rajput warriors, they fought until they died, or they captured the battlefield, conquered the battlefield. So, sometime, because the enemies were more in number, so sometime when they were defeated, these brave ladies, rather than being fallen in the hands of the enemies and then being badly treated, them, as I told you, the Muslims, they had large drums, they performed Johar. And what is Johar? That combinedly they used to jump into the fire. Because it was a matter of shame for them that somebody is using them as a slave. So they preferred being treated as a slave, preferred to die. That's how this social evil occurred during the medieval time. So, well, here, they constructed their fort palaces very strategically. And what they did here, there are three important features here. First, you saw a wall running all around this place with watchtowers at the regular intervals. You can see when you go there, you can see the watchtower from here as well. Can you see the watchtowers in the wall? So the soldiers were pointed there whenever they found something wrong. With the help of a red flag, they indicated it was Rani, and then they shifted to two more forts and topping the hill. So those were used during the war times only. So this is the first important feature. Another important feature, that you are on a hill back. So, and this wall runs for 14 miles nearly, more than 14 and a half miles, running all around this area. So second important feature, that you are on a hill back. So during the war times, you get an advantage, right? If you're on the higher post, you get an advantage. And third important feature, in the front, I mentioned about the lake which is dried up now, so that enemy couldn't carry the heavy guns and gunpowder along with that. And here, as these rulers, I told you about Mughal Emperor Akbar, that he accepted one of the princes from Jaipur royal family. So they had relations with the Mughals. So bit of Persian style architecture also you can find in their palace. You know, this palace, the foundation was laid by Maharaja Man Singh the First by the last decade of 16th century AD. But most of it, which we are seeing around here and the next part, that is by Mirza Raja Jai Singh the First. Jai Singh II was the one who settled the Jaipur city. The first who served three Mughal kings. He was the subordinate of three Mughal kings, Jahangir, Shah Jahan and Aurangzeb. So most of the fort palace here, what we are seeing around, is from 17th century AD. Only first quarter and second quarter of 17th century AD. But foundation was laid in the last decade of 16th century AD. And that particular place used to be the hall of public audience. As I told you so many times, what used to happen in the public audience, as the Maharaja, he sorted out public problems and receiving the ambassadors over there. And you can go over there, you can look down there, the beautiful garden, the lake. And from where you entered by the elephant down there, that is known as the Sun Gate, because that is facing the east. On the other side, where I came, where the jeep will be going back, that's known as Moon Gate. So there used to be drum house on the above the gate. So whenever someone special came, they started beating the drums and they announced that well, here comes so and so. The people inside, they can be prepared, Maharani, other maids, they can be prepared for the welcome. And this one known as the Lion Gate, where they check the entry tickets. So every morning, Maharaja, he was standing over there, and down there in the courtyard where the elephants left you, a sort of parade was performed. So he used to check whether his soldiers are doing well or not. In the surrounding, the corridor which he noticed, that was for the royal horses, elephants and the camels. And this is the main gate to the fort, to this palace. And on this gate, you can see the arches. That is Persian influence, as they had close contact with the Mughals. But we can see the elephants and all that. Living beings are not allowed in Islam, as I told you, so that's typically Hindu style of architecture. And technically we call this paintings tempera, which you can see. I mean, when, right now we are here because of the shade, but when you go there for taking picture, you can notice it's so beautiful. You know, that in particular type of technique, what they do in tempera, that they make a paste, and paste is applied on the wall, and when the surface is wet, powdered semi-precious stones are fixed in that. So technically that is known as tempera. So in the that corner there is a hammam as well, and this is the main gate. So that's why Lord Ganesha is the god of good luck, so you can find the image of Lord Ganesha as well. And the ladies, noble ladies, as they were not supposed to go publicly, so being unseen they were behind that filigree screen up there, you can see from there. So they witnessed the activities of the court from there, being unseen. Now 15 minutes, you can take pictures, look around, and our meeting place would be right here. Okay. Please don't go to the second part inside. We'll be going all together, then I'll be talking about some more things. So 15 minutes you can. Now please don't go inside.
Just outside.
These 15 minutes are for taking pictures only in this area. Okay? Then come back to me. We're gonna go inside all together, then we'll be talking little more things. So look around and come back right here. Don't go inside, please. We'll be going all together.
Downstairs, I saw.
told you about the wonderful cooling device system. Here we have another palace up there. How are we not supposed to go, but you can see from there, here. And you see in this...
People would talk.
So there is participant who was for support.
That's called biryani bowl. What's your phone number?
Yeah, I see that. Is that
Chinese word?
Yeah, yeah.
People up there.
Are those flags?
Are those people?
Those
are
people.
Like grazing the goats. So from here, you have a very good view of the old city. And those are the palaces where the king and queen they were living.
Maharaja Mahal Singh the First had 12 queens. You see, they were Hindu Maharajas as per the Hindu systems. I told you the other day that one man, one wife, not more than one. But polygamy was there. I mean, the Maharajas, quite often they had more than one queen, more than one Maharani. So what that means? That rules are always for the masses, not for the classes. So you know, but I hope you remember I showed you in a temple in Delhi, how that was an exception, that a lady had five husbands. But as per the Hindu system, normally one man, one wife, that's it. But anyway, this Maharaja had 12 queens, Maharaja Mahal Singh. So here, in this area, a separate apartment for each queen. Like this is out there as well, this is one apartment. And another one was living in that next apartment. So three apartments each side, and he had 12 queens. So they lived down here. And his own apartment used to be upstairs, up there. So it seems the lady who lived in the corner one, because her house is directly attached with Maharaja Mahal Singh's apartment in the staircase, so she was the most favored one. But you see, there was one Maharaja, 12 queens. So he was in great demand, of course. But they were not like the Mughal people, like Mughals. Mughals satisfied six or seven ladies at a time. This was pre-decided that Maharaja is going to spend this night with this particular queen. So the queen started preparing herself in advance. Like the modern ladies go to the beauty parlor, they had maids, fleets of concubines to burn for them. So they were taking bath with different kind of perfumes and all that. So they also, I mean, those ladies could also follow those things. I mean, the cosmetics and all that. They also had all these things. So, but one thing Maharani used to prepare herself. She prepared a powder. And the powder contained gold, silver, venom of cobra, when I say not 5 or 10 grams or 20 grams, just on the tip of the needle, that much of, and with some puffs. It was heated at 2000 degrees Celsius, but 2000 degrees Celsius is a very, very high temperature. If you heat something, any of the things, any substance, it will lose its nature, only the ashes will left. The ashes will remain. So Maharaja used to take this powder with milk before the sex, and he felt better that he gonna do better in the bath. So you know, this is controlled from here sometime. But Mughals were very, very practical in this way, because the doctors who produce different kind of aprosodics, how the Mughals, they satisfied six or seven ladies at a time. Doctors who produce different kind of aprosodics by that time, they were highly rewarded by the Mughal emperors. So one of the Mughal thing I tell you, you see, they made a paste contained honey, ginger, black pepper and some herbs. And this paste was applied in the female organ before the sex. So ladies, they reached an orgasm much sooner than the emperor. So that's how they satisfied six or the seven ladies. Okay. Still we have this kind of things. But if anybody want to know more and more about such things, you can talk to me in the evening, but by that time, $50 per minute for my speech. Anyways.
Okay.
No, but still we have these herbs. You see, nowadays, that all happened in these palaces. But see, let me tell you one thing about Indian society. When I used to go to school or the college, maybe it was, I was not supposed to talk about sex feeling. I'm talking about when I used to be in college, I'm talking about that's around when, 20 years back, more than that. So, but now things are changing. People are becoming more and more Westerners. But we are the people who wrote Kama Sutra 2000 years back.
Exactly.
I mean, this all these things, talking about sex became a taboo during the medieval time. Women were kept behind the wheels and girders, medieval time, when Islam reached here. Basically, this is not the part of us. And what the liberty what women had in India before Islam reached, we don't have only the gods, we have goddesses as well. No god is worshipped alone. I mean, in Islam they say Allah. There is no female version of Allah, it's only male. But in India we have gods, we have goddesses. So, equality. So, Kama Sutra is not just about having sex. We call it art of love making, but it is having do's and don'ts as well. That how a man's behavior should be towards his life partner, how a woman's behavior should be, or do's and don'ts towards his life partner. It's all about that. And there are 84 different gestures of lovemaking. Some of them are very, very acrobatic.
Oh.
You can buy a book, you can see those gestures, but don't try that at home.
No,
it's all the situation a lot. So I need to say that nowadays in Western countries, people conduct sex surveys and all that. We used to do that 2000 years back. That Rishi Saina, the man who wrote, apparently he wrote all that. It was his experience and by talking to the people. That's how we discovered. So we conducted such surveys 2000 years back. Anyway, so now what you can do is, if you just like to look around, you can look, all the apartments are same, but if you like to see any other one, washroom, still anybody want to use one washroom?
No, no, no.
Fine.
So, what's the washroom for you to It's in the corner.
Yeah, there's one in the corner, how it is. Don't want to use that. Okay, so, 10 minutes, if anybody like to look around, and then come right back here, and this way is on my right hand side of the entrance. Is it okay? 10 minutes to
back here.
Yeah, I mean, if you like to take pictures, if you like to see any other apartment, or if you like to go to Maharaja Mahal Singh's apartment, I can show you comfortable rent, or you can see all the apartments are similar. So you look around, and then come back here, and then we'll be going out to, and when you come back, I'll be dividing you in 5 groups. In 5 in each group, because there are going to be 5 people in each group. So that I'll be doing it from when you come back. 10 minutes, you look around. If anybody want to stay here, then stay here.
Is that the group in the drama?
Okay guys, so when we see how we can guide from the other, now we need to go to the jeep. We have 5 people in each jeep, 4 in the back and the front. I will go with him or I will go with her and do it now here. I will be riding in 5 different groups and I'll be saying group number 1 is group number 1. And group number 1 is group number 1. It's like chaos. I mean, things are out of the way. You are in India, it's not Australia, so please don't expect the thing in a systematic way. We have no system. So, by yourself, form the group of 5 and I will be giving you the group numbers. Fine?
Yes.
You got my point?
Yes,
5.
We're 4. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. 5. can't tell.
Tell me the number. Please, madam. I said morning came, I you.
I didn't ask it right. Can't look at that anymore.
There's a like, there's the odd few puddles in it hanging around, but the dirt still looks really dry.
Thank you. very good.
I don't think they stay there for long, they pull through.